This is Cubs Radio. Cubs Radio.
May 12th, right. I am back on the air. It's nice to be back. I've been away for a while because of my DJ business. I've been very, very busy. And now it's summertime. I get to take a break. And I have one of the nicest, most talented people I've ever sat next to. With me on my return. For real. I've John Blenn, I read a lot of stuff off the internet about John. I knew a lot of stuff about John Blenn. And for me, it's an honor to have you here tonight. And I really appreciate you being here.
That's very kind of you, Jerry. Thank you.
Thank you for being here. So, yeah. So you have been in the entertainment field since the, 80s? 70s?
Yeah, it's actually 45 years at this point, if I count my freshman year at NASA Community College, which is when I first started doing both journalism and also budding DJ on the radio station over at NASA Community College.
So you worked at NASA Community College as a DJ?
That was the first place I was, and then I continued my career at Hofstra for the second half of my my collegiate ride, and same thing, majored in communications, was a DJ for several years at Hofstra, and also wrote for their school papers.
Right, so reading all about your bio and everything like that, you are everything that, you know, I would love to be one of those things. Just one.
I can tell you a lot of that ride comes with being underpaid, but it's absolutely an enjoyable ride.
It's an amazing ride. Now, you know what? Not that money's not important, but money wouldn't matter to me much if I was to take that ride. That's awesome. You know, you couldn't pay me enough to do half the things you did. So, you know, so far, and you're still rolling.
Well, I have an older brother who's like 10 years older than I am, and he was the major catalyst in terms of getting me interested in the arts.
Okay.
When I was 8 years of age, we'd have show and tell in our classrooms, and the kids would bring in the Beach Boys or Simon and Garfunkel records or the Beatle records, and I would bring in things like Crabby Appleton or Fat Mattress, and my teacher would look at me and go, where are you getting this stuff?
Right.
I got a brother who's 10 years older than I am, and I'm listening to Frank Zappa at this point.
Right. So he was setting you up.
So he, yeah, when he moved out to California when I was 11, he left about half of his collection behind. So that immediately started me collecting records as well, and you know, and immediately snowballed from there. But that was the initial point of contact. Was my mom made sure that every Thursday night, as a teenager, he'd come home from work and spend that one night with me, no matter what.
Okay.
And that was always like new music night. He'd buy his records on Thursday afternoons and bring them home, and we'd listen to them together at that point.
That's awesome. Yeah. So that's a big inspiration for you there. Right?
Started my interest in the arts, you bet.
That's awesome. So that's back in elementary school?
Yeah, back in elementary school.
Okay.
And by the time I got to the point where I was going to go to college, I had made up my mind that the only thing I really wanted to do with my life was I wanted to be a radio DJ.
Music.
And not along the lines of like Howard Stern or, you know, a lot of the shock jocks that were on the air, but rather I wanted to be like Scott Muni, where you learned about the music and you turned people on to stuff and you played new things. So that was exactly what I went to school for. And ironically, all these years later, the only thing I haven't drawn a paycheck as is being an actual on-air DJ.
Right, I saw that. Right? You did everything but
everything else but, yeah.
So that's cool. But it brought you into all these other areas, right?
Without a doubt, yeah. I when I first got out of school, I went out to the Midwest to hit every place I could possibly find to get a radio job. Because the first thing they tell you is that you want to work in New York, get hired someplace else, and then come back, you know, as the arriving hero, so to speak.
Okay.
So I went out to the Midwest. I mean, I dropped tapes at like 300-400 stations. I mean, any place I could find, from Columbia, Missouri to like the smallest towns out in Nebraska, and nobody called me for a year.
Okay.
And I came back here, and I had been writing for Good Times Magazine at the end of my collegiate career as a freelancer. And at that point had broken through a little bit. But when I came back, I took a job as a salesperson with them, and within a month, the editor who had been there left, and that made me heir apparent to the editor's job.
Oh, nice.
So I became the editor at Good Times, and the boss there basically let me run 99% of the time with cover what you want to cover, or just make sure we get names that people will recognize and go after, you know, whatever you're able to bring in for the paper that people want to pick up and read. And at that point, a few months afterwards, I'm getting phone calls a year later from Springfield, Missouri with, you want to be the overnight guy?
Or,
hey, we'd like you to do the weekend drive, you know? And at that point, I had become a journalist, realized that that was a better gig by far. So I no longer had that interest. It's kind of like somebody asked me about it last week, and I said it's kind of like picturing yourself as being in a bumper ball game where a little thing hits you and changes your direction subtly.
Right.
Because I didn't initially get those radio jobs and that pinball situation, I pinballed off to being a journalist and writing, which still allowed me to turn people on to new music, which still allowed me to go to shows and learn about things. But the beauty of being a journalist, and especially with Good Times, was it gave me an opportunity to cover things besides just music.
Right.
I could do comedy. I could cover theater. I could interview actors. I could do film. So it gave me a much greater variety of places that I could get involved with. And they also don't tell you in radio when you're in college much about program directors.
Okay.
You have a program director when you're at college who says, hey, would you stop playing that damn record off the fourth shelf in there? It doesn't fit the format.
Oh, okay.
But when you get to a pro radio station, it's, here's the 38 songs we're playing today, and between 404 and 408, you can pick one song out of these four albums here to play.
So you can use your
So own. You don't get as much creative input or ability to bring things to people's attention, which was the whole bottom line of me wanting to do it in the first place, was to bring things to people's attention.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. That's to discover somebody. Yeah.
So you can become a program director, obviously, but that's not what you do with your first job. You go through several jobs and hope that you land in a place where you can move yourself into a position like that.
Right. So did location have anything to do with you besides you fell into Good Times magazine? I mean, you could have been out in Missouri, you said, right?
Yeah, I always fell in love with St. Louis, and it's funny. I probably would have moved there if I didn't get so deeply involved with the music and entertainment scene here in New York, which ironically, most people come here because they want to. I grew up here, you know, in East Meadow. So to me, I always remembered Bob Costa saying that he moved to St. Louis and he was a Comac boy from Long Island.
Right.
And I saw him on a show one night and I thought, why would he go there? He said, well, as a sports announcer, my work is going to be in New York, Chicago, or California. So it's no longer than a 2.5 plane ride and 2.5 hour plane ride in any direction to do my job. And that's brilliant. You can live in suburbia and still work in the big cities and do that.
Right.
But of course, you got to get to a fairly high level to be that guy flying around the country doing it.
Right.
But the thing I liked about St. Louis, and my brother spent a lot of time out there, was it was very much like Long Island when I was growing up. Their suburbs looked like our suburbs 20 years earlier.
Okay.
So it had a certain amount of nostalgic connection. But as it worked out, much better off being here.
I got to tell you, I mean, I've seen you for years around all over the place. You know, you're everywhere, right? And you can admit that. You never sit still, probably. But so you are like Mr. Long Island in a lot of ways. You know, you look at Bobby Knight, you're Mr. Long Island. But in the field of entertainment, you are, I would consider, one of the top Mr. Long Islands that I could, you know, out there.
Well, that's kind of you to say, too. I mean, I was a typical road rat where I was out on the road 7 nights a week. And, I mean, I didn't get married until I was 33.
Okay.
When I met my wife, Joni, and it's actually going to be 30 years at this point this summer. She was very much like I was. You know, we didn't have kids, so she was a graphic artist and actually still is, but she would take pictures. So she was always up for, hey, do you want to go to this? And she didn't care whether I was dragging her off to a heavy metal show or professional wrestling or, you know, she was always up for the adventure with that, which I knew, you know, very short order, this is the right person to spend the rest of my life with.
Exactly.
But she allowed me to do a lot of that moving around, too. Before that, as a bachelor, you can come and go as you want to.
Right.
And it wasn't uncommon for me to go out, cover a show at 7 o'clock in Suffolk County, a show at 9:30 in New York, and then or in Nassau County, and then be in Manhattan at midnight to catch a late show somewhere because you were able to, A, drive around much quicker than you can now.
Right.
But, two, you also have that energy and that youthful desire to do it. I'm not that guy anymore, but I still keep as brisk a pace as I can.
Yeah, I mean, you know, through Facebook, I could see that you take the best pictures. I guess your wife has the camera, too.
Yeah, it's actually both of us. So, yeah, the majority of the stuff is her most of the time. And the further you go back, the more likely it was her. And quite obviously, anything I'm in, I didn't shoot myself.
Right. I mean, you got some great candid shots of comedians and musicians all the time. And it's, like, very interesting. You know, whenever you post something, you never post anything. It's always something that you want to look at. You know, like 30 pictures of, like, I guess the whole month or 2 weeks worth of entertainment.
Well, that's nice of you to say as well. I mean, my feelings is in terms of posting things on social media, simply a lot of people dump 200 pictures out at once. I won't.
Right.
You know, I'll put out like maybe 20 on any given night, and, you know, 8 of local artists, 8 of national touring artists, maybe 4 or 8 of local musicians, mm-hmm. or comedians or sporting events or some theater piece I might have been at. Because, A, it's more interesting when you're not getting overloaded with one thing. People come into my page just about every night just to see if their picture from somewhere on the line popped up there.
Yep.
And I just think it's a good way to keep people's attention on the arts out here, and that the people that are working around our community all the time. And it's funny because, as you mentioned about posting pictures, when I first got on Facebook like 13, 14 years ago, I put up a lot of stuff pretty quickly, and I got a phone call from Dennis Regan, the stand-up comedian, Brian's brother.
Yeah.
And he said, "Are you dying?" It's like, "Do you know something I don't?"
Right.
It's like, "You okay?" And I'm like, "Yeah, I'm fine. Why?" He goes, "You put up like 100 pictures of comedians, right. and none of them are you."
Right.
And I said, "Well, I put up about 12 or 16 of them, and I started getting text messages and emails from people going, 'Oh my God, do you have a photo of me? I don't have any shots of me from the 80s, or I moved 12 times. I don't even have a black and white of my band anymore. Do right. you?' And I had all that stuff from being a variety of papers with Good Times, The Islander, and then my wife and I had Long Island Entertainment together for 6 years as well.
Right.
So yeah, we still had a lot of files of stuff. And I said, let me see what I got. And you start digging and start pulling it out. And I realized, you know, in those days, you didn't have your cell phone in your pocket.
No, you didn't have a million
but
pictures.
But I went almost everywhere with a 110 in my pocket, no matter what. And you pulled that little thing out, and you got a couple of semi-blurry shots, but it caught that moment in time, and there's no way to go back and do those things over. So,
no, you could take those photos and scan them and fix them up, too, and make them look nicer. And
that's exactly right.
Yeah. So, yeah, very interesting. And then I was going to go back in your history, but also, I think, not every night, maybe every night, you put up a picture and say, who do we have here?
Right.
That's awesome, you know, and you know, sometimes you see right away with the eyes, like, you know, it's John Travolta or whoever, but that's a great guessing game, you know?
Yeah, it's a fun thing. I initially started out with posting a couple of pictures about 5 or 6 years ago of meanwhile back in high school.
Right.
And I just put it up so that people look at it going, oh, that's a great shot of, as you said, Travolta, or hey, look at Anne Margaret when she was 20, you know, when she was 18.
High school and yearbook.
People immediately started guessing who it was, like putting the names up underneath it. Is it this? Is it that? And I quickly realized that people really love that stuff. And everybody goes back to look at their high school photos and, gee, I wonder what Tom looked like, you know, 35 years ago, now that I'm standing at a reunion with him. Or, hey, I forget what Sally used to look like.
Right.
And now people will come every night to take a look at it and see if it's something that they can recognize or not.
I am one of those people.
I look every night.
Do you?
Every night.
I'm one of those people. Yeah. So it's called Looky Who We Have Here or something like that?
Well, I also put Who Do We Have Here, because at some point it gets harder and harder and harder. I've tried not to in 5 years to run the same graduation picture twice.
Right.
So then eventually you get to a point where there's a lot of people there aren't graduation pictures, but there's a lot of shots on them. You're like, gee, let me see if anybody knows who this is or who that is.
It's different.
And it's funny. A couple of days ago, I put up a picture of an actress named Janina Gavankar.
Okay.
And she's currently a regular on Big Sky, which is one of the bigger hits over the last couple of years on network TV.
Nice.
On ABC.
Right.
And I was surprised a couple of people immediately guessed who she was. And then people were sending me private messages with, oh my God, wasn't she great on True Blood? I'm like, wow, I didn't watch True Blood. Is that where she's from? And I go back, and sure enough, she's on True Blood for like 5 or 6 years. So when I post stuff, it's like from a point of reference of where they've hit my radar conscious-wise.
Right.
But there's so many other places other people knew them from that I didn't. So in a lot of ways, I learn as much about who these people are by posting it as people do by looking at it and then researching who it is.
Right. So. I have one with me.
Sure.
Do you mind?
Sure.
All right, let's see if John... I just bought one. Well, it's actually two pictures, same person. Let's see if John Blenn can tell who this is.
That looks like Goomba Johnny. Now I got Goomba Johnny stuck in my head, but it's not. He's a stand-up comic, obviously.
Goomba Johnny's good. I like that. I like what you... Yep, that's good.
Who do you got?
All right, I'll give you a hint.
Okay.
It's probably the biggest hint I can give you. Are you ready?
Yep.
The person...
Is he on Network News?
No.
Okay. For a second, I thought it was Tucker Carlson.
No.
He's got some Tucker Carlson in his face, too.
Believe it or not, that person's in this room.
That's you.
That's me.
That, wow.
1998.
Amazing.
That's when I first got my puppet Roger. Yep, that's...
I did not know that you were a ventriloquist.
I am a ventriloquist wannabe.
Well, if you went to the trouble of actually getting a dummy, you have some skills, or you wouldn't have made the expenditure.
Right. That's when I first started doing stand-up, like, for real. You know, before that, I actually did a show that you were there, and I mentioned it to you once before, 1993, mm-hmm. I think it was, at the Smithtown Sheridan.
Mm-hmm.
I think you were there with Good Times Magazine at the time, right?
I would have been with Good Times in 93, yes.
Right, so you were at the show because your name's on the flyer, which I found. And I was a comedian in between bands.
Mm-hmm.
And so back in 90, from 90 to 93, 94, I was doing comedy in between bands anywhere. I would just do it just for stage time, anywhere. Okay. And I couldn't be a singer. I had bad timing.
Mm-hmm.
So because my timing was so bad, I always liked being on stage and being a ham. I do stand up. But you were at the show. It was a fundraiser for the sound man. His last name, I think it was Schneider. He was another color sound man. His van was broken into, and they stole his equipment, and we did a fundraiser to...
It was Dark White on that bill, too? I'm trying to think of... I think that was one of the groups that played that day, if I'm not mistaken.
I believe so. I'll find the... I think so. I think Zebra was there. I think Randy Jackson was there.
Too? Yeah, I just saw Randy last week, actually. Right. Still going strong.
So the embarrassing thing for me that night was, you know, I had comedy all written and stuff like that. I want to... long story short, I followed somebody who juggled fire. So it doesn't matter how funny you are, if the guy before you is juggling fire and you come out, nobody's paying attention to you, you know.
Well, you know, don't feel bad on that. Number one, I was at a fundraiser that they had at Eastside Comedy, and Bob Nelson went up, followed by Jackie Martling,
okay,
followed by a very new comedian named Adam Ferrara.
Okay.
And Richie Minervini was in the back of the room laughing with a couple of people going, right, it's going to make him a better comedian. Don't worry about him. He'll be all right. And Adam went up there like he owned the place, completely confident and absolutely shined. But that's kind of a dirty trick to do to somebody brand new. And, let's say Nelson and Martling and then you.
Right, right.
You know, and he went up there. And at that point, you look at a guy like him and go, he's going to make it.
Good.
There's no question about
it. You knew it, right?
If you get nervous and you don't do well, that doesn't tell you anything either. Because almost, you know, every stand-up will tell you somewhere along the line they bombed somewhere. And if they didn't tell you that, they're probably still bombing, and they're not admitting the truth.
I've spent a lot of time bombing, and you know, and I got so immune to bombing that it didn't matter as much anymore as I got older.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when I started to get better because I wasn't so worried about what people were thinking.
You can't worry about what people were thinking. And I'll also say, too, it's funny. I was in this building one Memorial Day many years ago here at Governor's, and Dan Wilson and Eddie Brill went out to do a late show.
Right.
There were 12 people in the audience. It was a Memorial Day weekend. Right. It's a late show on a Friday night, as it was. And, of course, I used to go in and do most of my reviewing on late shows on Friday when they used to be an 11 or 11:30 show at all these clubs. And the comedians would look at me and go, you SOB, what are you doing here now? Why don't you come tomorrow at like 8?
Right.
Because tomorrow at 8 o'clock, you can go out there and sneeze on yourself and they're going to laugh their heads off because Saturday night 8 o'clock audiences are happy. They've been relaxed all day. They're having some casual cocktails, and they're more than predisposed to laugh.
Right.
Late show on Friday, you've got to go to work and show people what you're made of. And Eddie Brill and Dan Wilson that night put on one of the best performances I ever saw either one of them do. And, of course, they're both top flight headlining comedians that have played all over the country. But you couldn't tell if you were in Madison Square Garden in front of 20,000 people or you were in a room with 10 other people because they went and approached it like that and performed as pros and did a great job, and everybody who walked out of that room got their money's worth 10 times over by that type of an effort.
Yeah.
And then you see other guys that go out there some nights and they sit down on the stool, they suck the drink, they just kind of look around 25 times like, so what else? That's not doing your job.
Yeah. I'm a DJ too on the weekends, and like what you just described, I do a lot of parties, and most of them they're all pretty good. Sometimes you go to a party, nobody wants to dance, but you will find that one couple that will dance, and you find out what kind of music they like, and you're being paid to be there. And I just keep them on the floor as long as I, you know, and that's, you know, or the one kid who was going to dance to do the chicken dance, or the limbo, but I'm being paid to be there, and I'm going to entertain it. Easily, you can sit back and say, hey, they're dancing, screw them. But you're going to find that one person. Yeah, do I belong here?
You belong here.
We all come from that those kind of backgrounds, Joey. Yeah. I mean, my dad was a Nassau County cop for 35 right. years. He also was the director of the Nassau County Traffic Safety Board. His claim to fame in his career was he's the guy responsible for the development and implementation of the breathalyzer tests in the field
oh,
in
wow.
those cars. He's also responsible for Safety Town over there in Eisenhower Park.
Oh, really?
He got that built and designed.
Wow.
Me, on the other hand, people went, your dad was a cop, you know, with a specialty in like DWIs. And
right.
You spent your whole life in bars covering bands?
Like, right.
Yeah, and you did that. I got home as sober as a priest at the
right.
end of the
right.
Because I wasn't going to get him mad at me. But my dad, when I was getting near the end of college, would hand me civil service, applications left and right
to get you.
He'd be like, you know, this will be good for you. You know, I could help you get a job here working for the county. I could help you get a job working for the town or whatever. And every night my mom would be like, if you don't want to do that, then you go follow your heart. Boom, into the garbage can and shred them.
Nice.
And my mom always stood my artistic bent. My dad never got it.
Yeah.
And ironically, my mom didn't live to see me do my first movie, and my dad did. My dad went with me to the movie theater to see Here Comes the Boom. My wife, ironically, was in Florida with her sister when the day it came out. So I took my dad to the local movie theater to see it with me.
Nice.
And I come up on the screen, and he's looking at me like a six-month-old pooping their diaper. Nothing. I mean, I looked at him a couple of times like, that's me, Dad.
Yeah.
He's like,
yeah.
And afterwards, he's like, well, okay. Absolutely unmoved.
Right.
Meanwhile, when my dad was a kid, he ran into Gene Autry over in the Mineola movie theater here.
Oh, wow.
And Gene Autry looked at him and went, howdy, partner. How are you? And my dad froze. It was my dad's all-time hero. My dad lived to 98, and he's like, I couldn't even speak to Gene Autry.
Right.
And meanwhile, here's your own son doing a movie. It's not even like that, a boy. There you go.
Right, right.
I never doubted that he was proud of me.
Yes.
But he never got my journey because he was never into the arts.
Right.
After my mom passed, I got back cartoons she drew of members of her family. She used to mail them letters and do cartoons of all of them.
Right.
I was like, what a brilliant freehand artist. And I knew she worked for Doubleday, but I never realized she always kind of had aspirations in the back of her head of being a writer. So I was, in a lot of ways, her journey.
Right.
And she never told me. So she was the reason I got to that point. My grandmother was like the mayor of Syracuse. She was out of control. She'd walk into a bar and she'd come out 20 minutes later and be on a first name basis with everybody in
social, right?
She was the life of the party.
Right.
And my grandfather was a professional boxer before he went into World War I, and he was absolutely stoic as a statue in a park. Nothing. So you become who you're meant to become through your bloodlines, whether you know it or not. But you still got to follow your dream. You can't let whatever's come before you change your mind on it.
My mom's the one who got me into this position I'm in today, whatever it is, whatever you want to call it. But she, just like you said, and my dad was the one who doesn't get it.
Right.
You know, like he worked at Pan American Airlines. He got me a job there. I worked there. Like I followed all his advice and stuff like that through the years. But my mom was the one who pushed me into being funny, I guess. You know, like she loved to laugh. My whole life, she loved to laugh. And I did whatever I could to make her laugh.
Right.
And I'll just tell you real quick, one of the nicest things I said it before was I had the ventriloquist puppet up in Brokerage, and I was up on stage with the ventriloquist puppet, and the video is on YouTube. At the end of people laughing, as it settles down, you hear my mom's laugh two more times. And I can hear it to this day. She passed away too. I can hear it to this day. I can hear that ha, ha, ha. Mm-hmm. You know, she really, I love making her laugh. So they used to call you, because I've seen you do it a bunch of times, the hockey teacher, or what was it, the five pounds?
They call me Professor Hockey Man.
Professor Hockey Man. That's awesome. So you love hockey as much as I do.
Absolutely. I got 390 jerseys at home.
Right.
So literally everything is on my back but a Ranger jersey.
Oh, really?
Never worn a Red Sox jersey in the baseball side of things. There's certain things I can't put on, but
I agree.
Hockey, I got everything but a Ranger jersey.
I agree, and you might hate me for this. Yeah. But I did root for the Rangers. It's not just me. Like I'm the same way with you. But like my kids now, my one daughter likes the Rangers because the boy she likes the Rangers. So they're watching the Ranger game. They're rooting for the Rangers. And I, you know, as much as I can't stand it, you want to see your kids happy, right?
Of course.
So I rooted for the Rangers. But yeah, so you're a huge Islander fan. I've seen you. You were at all the parades, right? Up and down Hempstead Turnpike?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, on the occasion of my 21st birthday, the headline on the back of Newsday said, Islanders win first cup. because they won the night before. And I know exactly where I was. Right, I was right here on Hempstead Turnpike. I was working in Modell's for the sporting goods department.
Okay.
And I had just gotten off of work at 5 o'clock, and they won approximately 5:30 in the afternoon.
The first one.
We went down to the television department, and they had the game on there.
Oh, nice.
And we watched a winning goal get scored.
Oh, nice.
So yeah, we immediately went down to the supermarket, which they had in Modell's in those days, bought some champagne rather cheaply,
right,
and immediately headed right out the front door of Modell's to Hempstead Turnpike, which became the parade,
yep,
that day.
Yep.
Literally, it was from Meadowbrook Park, where it was from the Coliseum, down to the Wanto State Parkway, and then loop and come back up the other side. So there's this big circle going on for like 2.5 hours. I don't think we left Hempstead Turnpike that entire time. And it was so much fun, in fact, that the cops started showing up just to make sure nobody was walking in front of the cars,
right,
or whatever.
Right.
And there was a cop standing next to my buddy, and he tapped him on the shoulder and held up the champagne bottle. The cop took it, looked one way, looked the other, and took a sip, because in those days, you're not worrying about where the cell phone is.
There's so, no video.
Yeah,
no
he
cameras,
had a little swig with us just to be sociable.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was nothing approached that. The following 3 years were great. They won a couple of them on the road, but that night, that moment in
that
time
day,
is just a remarkable memory.
I'll tell you
a funny story about the Islanders, actually. When I was in my second year at Nassau Community College, I was in a journalism course, and I had to go and interview a celebrity. So I went to the Coliseum, and I approached their PR people, and I said I wanted to interview Brian Trottier. And they said, well, you know, we'll look into it. A couple days later, Brian Trottier is at Alexander's over in the Roosevelt Field Mall.
Oh, wow.
Signing a book.
Right.
So I go up to him. I say, hi, I'm going to Nassau Community College. Can I, you know, do an interview with you for my class? And he said, yeah, sure, just get in touch with the PR guy who I already met a couple days earlier. Well, I got about 2 months lead time to get the thing done. They postpone it once. They postpone it twice. They postpone it three times. Finally, it's 2 days before this thing's due is on the final of my class. And I call up the PR guy. I guess, well, come down to the Coliseum, you know, tomorrow, and we'll get it done. So I go down there, and he said, the practice is over with. The paper's due the following day. And Brian Trottier comes off, and I said, hi, you know, I'm John Blenn. I met you. And he's like looking at me like he'd never seen me before.
Right.
And then I said to him, look, I'm going to fail this course. Can I just do this with you for 15 minutes?
Yeah.
Kid, life isn't always fair.
Oh, man.
No.
And he walks away from me like, what?
Wow.
It's like, you know, you're 19. It's like, nobody even pulled that on you at 19. It's like, what?
Yeah, life isn't like not fair to like 47.
Yeah. especially then. I mean, this is back in the
70s. Life is fair.
No, right after Trottier walked away from me, Glenn Resch, Chico Resch, comes up behind me and goes, can I help you?
Nice.
And I said, well, I haven't really done a lot of research, but yes. And he's like, all right, I got one stipulation. It's going to seem crazy to you, but do you mind doing the interview in the shower? I'm like,
time is an essence?
No, but okay.
Right.
So, you know, jump ahead 10 minutes. He's literally showering, and I'm literally sitting on a wooden chair just out of the spray going, so after you played at the University of Minnesota, you know, he was like the most obliging, wonderful interview.
I knew
a little bit about him,
yeah,
but he expounded on everything I didn't know a lot about.
Right.
And I brought the interview in. I typed it up. I got an A the following day. He goes, wow, you must have really prepped for this guy. I was like, no, he's just like the best interview in the world. And my teacher smiled and went, you're going to do all right at this if this is the road you go, man.
Right.
Yeah, it's going to be fine.
That's awesome.
I jump ahead to sports
you
ticker.
You are a really good writer.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you.
You are.
I was working for sports ticker briefly like a decade ago, and I'm at the Coliseum covering a game for ESPN sports ticker, like calling in the goals and penalties, et cetera. In between periods, I go up to their snack room up there for the press, and like, oh, sure. They hold the door up. I'm like, wow, they really... I'm really doing this.
Right.
So who's standing there scooping out a little food? Glenn Resch. At that point, he was an announcer for the Devils.
Right, yes.
And I walked up to him and I said, Mr. Resch, I just wanted to say, like 35 years ago, I was stuck on an interview. Trottier stood me up and you stood in for him and I got an A on that. And you helped me get my career started as a journalist and I'll always appreciate it. He turned around and he smiled and he goes, well, you made it. Welcome. He put his hands out and shook hands with me, patted me on the shoulder, and walked away.
Very nice.
That was the only conversation I've had with him since that interview.
Right.
More than enough.
Right.
But great guy. Always root for him. Lovely human being.
Oh, he's great.
The mother in me is like, thank goodness he didn't molest you in the shower.
I know.
My mind did what? It's like he had to get dressed, and he didn't have enough time to hang out afterwards. So literally, I talked to him in the shower.
The helicopter mom and me just went, I know. What?
I know. Well, he sat on the wooden chair facing the other way.
Yeah, I'm like, literally, and then?
So I love the pictures of you with Eddie Money and your stories with Eddie Money. And Eddie Money was a great friend of yours.
Absolutely. Eddie became a brother late in my life, and so did his entire band and crew. They were all a great family, and I was really blessed to be close to them for years.
Right. So I recently saw Eddie Money at Burns Park. I believe he performed there maybe 7 or 8 years ago. I'm not even sure.
Yeah, I'm going to say 16, I think it was.
Was it a long time ago? 2016.
Right.
Yes, you're right. But Eddie Money story, when I see your Eddie Money stuff, I wanted to tell you the story was, and I don't know if it's true, but we grew up on Thanksgiving. A limo went past our house every Thanksgiving. That's Eddie Money. He's going to his mother's house for Thanksgiving dinner. We lived off Red Maple Drive in Levittown. Yep. And that would be, he would have lived behind like the Levittown Park Bake Shop somewhere, like Elm Drive or something in that area.
He grew up right in that Plain Edge section over there and went to Island Trees.
So then that's true then, because everybody would say, that's Eddie Money's limo. You know.
His sister and brother-in-law lived over there up until about 4 years ago when they finally moved to Florida. But yeah, that was his final connection to the island, was the two of them were still here.
Oh, okay. So it's true then.
I never knew it was true. He's Long Island through and through. Ironically, he's the same exact age as my brother. They were both born in 1949.
Okay.
Which is quite a year out here, because Billy Joel was born in 49 too.
Okay.
So, Eddie was somebody that I crisscrossed with a few times. I interviewed him for Good Times. I interviewed him for Long Island Entertainment. He was at Westbury Music Fair when I was a general manager over there.
Okay.
The first time I ever saw him was when he played the Coliseum opening up for Meatloaf right after his debut album came out.
Wow.
And it was funny that when he wrote his original autobiographical musical called Two Tickets to Paradise,
yes,
he wanted to produce it. They took it to a couple of places out here and said, well, it'll take us 2 years to put it together.
Yeah.
So Frank and Gordon McKay, who are very dear friends of mine, who are both from the island, both wrote for me at one point at Good Times. They brought him over to Five Towns and said, do you think you can do this for Eddie? And he's like, yeah, we can get this up in a few months if he wants to do it. Absolutely.
Right.
So I sat down with Eddie. We did it. And we immediately clicked. I immediately put together cast for him. He said, I'll bring the band to play it. And we were about a month into rehearsals. He goes, Johnny, why do I feel like I know you? Because I sat in your living room having tea with your dad and you and your mom. You made me a sandwich over there. Oh, you worked Westbury Music Fair with me a couple of times when I was general manager. Oh, yeah. I used to write for Good Times, and I covered you over interview days. Like, that's where you live. It was like, it took him a month to realize we had that much history together.
Right.
I didn't say a word to him about it. I'm just working with him every night.
Right.
But he was just like the funniest guy in the world. He always had a joke. I never saw anybody make other people feel completely at ease faster than him.
That's what I pick up on.
And he was one of those guys that he wouldn't talk to you any differently than Mick Jagger or, you know, the Gandhi or anybody else. Eddie was just one of those down-to-earth guys, and we immediately clicked, and I was blessed to be able to direct his play a couple of times.
That's awesome. Yeah, I saw the new, I think it was News 12 piece on that. It was 2 years to get the play together, and I saw Eddie Money being interviewed, and I think it was a 15-year-old kid that played Eddie Money in it.
Yeah, well, the first time around was a kid named Jesse Kanch, who right now is, I know, has been battling some medical issues, and we're all praying that everything comes through for him.
Okay.
He put out an album out on Capitol Records, and he won one of those like American Idol-type shows.
Oh, nice.
It was only on 1 year on ABC. Cannot think of the name of it, but Josh Groban was the host of it.
I remember that.
And
Brad, and
he was he won that entire first year.
Oh,
got
really?
An album out.
Very cool. So another Eddie Money story that I have, his limo went past my house on, you know, Thanksgiving back then, you're out there playing football while mom's cooking the turkey with your cousins, right? And the limo comes by, it's Eddie Money. So when I got older and I had to leave, my parents got divorced and just things were crazy. And I had a job offer in Florida and I was like 18 years old and my sister was 13. So long story short, this is my visual of Eddie Money, is I'm in my van, everything I own is in the back of my van, packed to the ceiling, my mattress, everything. You know, I'm 18 years old and I'm getting out of here. I look to my right and there's my mom. She didn't think I'd really do it. You know, it's one of those things like, go ahead, move to Florida, go ahead. And then I'm actually pulling away. She's looking at the door like, her eyes are like, and my little sister with pigtails like Cindy Brady, you know, she's like, the song on the radio was I Want to Go Back. And as I'm driving down my block, I want to go back and do it all over. From my house to my friend's house, we drove before. Actually, it's such an emotional. To this day, that song reminds me of that. You know, it's just a touching song.
We all have that in common, that Eddie and yourself and I were all very close with our mothers.
You right.
know? And same thing, Eddie's father was the cop, was very stern, like, you're not going to be a cop.
Right.
And his mother's like, Eddie, you follow your star and you do what you're going to do. And Eddie one day packed it up and moved out to San Francisco to chase his career, which is where Billy Graham found him. And he really broke out of getting signed in San Francisco, but he was always a Long Islander at heart.
Now, he's extremely talented, no doubt. My thoughts are is that his personality also, when you're a nice guy like Eddie Money, everybody's going to pull for you too. I mean, I'm saying talent first, definite, but also with talent, I think.
Yeah, I think, you know, Eddie had that point in the middle of his career where he almost killed himself because he was just living too wild. He'd be the first one to tell you.
Right.
The later stages of his life, he got married to Lori and wound up having 5 kids and very stable father, loved family. Family was everything to right. Eddie. I think that people always pulled for him because he was a likable guy. The only people who don't seem to like him are the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, who he always said, I don't think they're ever going to put me in. But, you know, they're never going to put Toto in either. If you're not part of their fan club
right.
at Rolling Stone, you don't wind up in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. But Eddie was always very proud of the fact that he wound up in the Long Island Music Hall of Fame.
That's awesome.
That meant more to him. It really honestly did.
That is awesome. Eddie Money's a big part of my life, and you were good friends with him. I just think that's a great connection there. So, journalist for 38 years, SAG member. I didn't even get into the fact that you did a film, 9/11, with Charlie Sheen, Whoopi Goldberg, Gina Gershon, Bronx Bull. I wanted the Bronx Bull was Long Beach International. That's on the boardwalk, the Long Beach International Film Festival?
Yes.
Right on the boardwalk, because I went there one year. It was really cool.
Yeah, we were that particular year. It was held at Molloy for whatever reason.
Okay.
Ironically, that's where Eddie Money wound up doing his play the second time. So we have connection. My wife is a graduate of Molloy, so there's got to be something in there.
Some
where
kind
Molloy
of some,
means something to my life. I haven't
some
quite
kind
figured
of power.
Out yet.
Some kind of yeah. Something's drawing that together.
But yeah, they did have that over there at that film festival, and it was really really fun to be part of that and to be able to go out and participate. It was fun doing the movie too. I mean, I got to work with William Forsythe, who's one of the great character actors in the business. He played. The Bronx Bull.
Right.
We also, Paul Sorvino was in that. What a wonderful gentleman, one of the most intelligent, well-informed people on everything I ever met. He really is like a Renaissance guy. Penelope Ann Miller, who of course was in Scarface, among other things, was also in that film.
Oh, everything she's in, she's great.
Yeah, she really, and she's just as sweet a human being as you could ever meet too. Just an absolute doll to talk to. So yeah, that was an absolutely great memory of being part of that.
And the other thing I was looking at was Here Comes the Boom with Kevin James.
Yeah, I also did some background work in Mall Cop as well,
right.
The first Mall Cop movie. Kevin was at my wedding many years ago, is a dear friend, and has right. been incredibly kind to me. Very happy for all of his success.
Oh, definitely.
I actually most recently saw Kevin in Syosset at the Cultural Arts Playhouse. He did a play one weekend with his kids.
Oh, wow.
All 4 of them were in, not Fiddler on the Roof, the one with Fagin, I'm trying to think now, Oliver.
Oliver.
And yeah, and Kevin played Fagin in that particular piece.
Oh, that's funny.
But he only did the middle 3 shows of a month-long run.
Right.
And we were able to sneak in and catch one of those. And it was fun to see the joy with him working with his kids. But Kevin has always been an incredible gentleman and very generous to me.
Kevin James, well, anybody, you could even say this. Kevin James at night is on Channel 34, I think it is. Every night, The Kings of Queens.
Yeah, that's
the reruns.
That is the show that will keep on giving forever. But yeah, he had a great run with that.
Yeah.
And he really doesn't have to do another thing the rest of his life because of the success of it. But
it's
he
awesome,
still
man.
Keeps working and doing fun stuff.
Yeah, it's just, you know, it's on every night. Every night when my wife and I are going to bed, it's just one of the things that you wind down to watching and you start laughing together. And that show was so well written that any married couple can relate to half the things that they're going through.
That's a secret with any great show.
Right?
Is that it has
excellent
that
writing.
Familiarity to the audience that's watching it, and you have that connectivity to it.
Yeah, and now my dad's not living with me, but now I have my dad. You know, like, we're going to go on vacation in Florida, bringing my dad with me. It's almost like Kings of Queens in a way. So it's very relatable, and that's great writing. And I love Kevin James. You know, I know he comes here. He popped in here once when I was taking a comedy class. And I was like, whoa. You know, he's working out some new material. He was doing Westbury or something like that. And he popped in here. I think he was doing Westbury on a Saturday. He came in here on a Thursday. We had a writing class. And I almost fell off my chair.
Yeah, he's smart. And I mean, he's been at it for a lot of years. He'll go tune up something he's going to try in a bigger venue a couple of days beforehand.
Right.
So,
right.
Yeah, he regularly pops into these clubs to do exactly that.
Yeah, I've seen pictures of you through the years on the internet. I've seen you with Ray Romano, Adam Ferrara, Bob Nelson. I mean, you know everybody. You know, you're just like, you're
I first started covering comedy back in the the mid-80s. I was actually with the Island Era when I first started doing it and then brought it over to Good Times with me. But there were not a lot of people out here actually covering it as an art form, and I always found that fascinating because what's the difference between a one-man show and stand-up comedy? And Nick Verminsky, who used to book The Brokerage, I went out to 30 shows with him in 30 nights before I wrote the first word of reviewing the show.
Right.
And Nick was brilliant. Nick would be like, oh, this guy's a monologist, and his specialty is this. And this guy, he's a prop comic, and what he does is this. And like, he understood the science of it all inside and out, and I was learning from him and watching, going, oh, I get it. Oh, I understand it. Oh, I see why he's special. Oh, I see why that doesn't work. And so by the time I wrote my first review, which was covering a Jeff Zabrowski open mic night here,
okay,
it's like, Jeff goes, what do you know about this? I went, more than you might think. But okay, let's let it go. But the interesting thing about studying like that, there were two guys in this country covering stand-up comedy, not from doing interviews, but rather breaking it down and reviewing it. The other guy's name was Hank Gallo, and he was with the New York Post. And it wasn't for long, because shortly thereafter, Gallo got hired by The Daily Show to be one of their producers.
Oh, wow.
So then all of a sudden, it was me. And I'd get phone calls from guys in Vancouver going, I'm coming into Governor's. Could you come out and review my show? I work with this guy on a cruise ship that's from Long Island. He mentioned you. So I start getting phone calls from all over the country with, I'm coming into your area. Could you come and stop by a show? And at that point, it was fun. We put a regular column into Good Times of covering two or three shows every single week.
That's cool.
And started doing interviews with so many comedians that came out of this circuit.
Wow.
You know, the first cover story Kevin and Adam ever had, we put the two of them on the cover with Anthrax.
Good Times?
They both called me up at Good Times going, we're on the cover with Anthrax. It's like, yeah. And it was fun to see the excitement with
both of them. Better than Anthrax.
Some of our readers,
you're
like,
welcome.
Who's Anthrax? You know, they knew Kevin or Adam were, but they weren't headbangers. I mean, one of the cover stories I did was with Tim Allen, and I got chewed out for it because my boss said, nobody has any idea who this is.
Really?
And I had gotten the interview with Tim. He was headlining at The Brokerage, and when I sat down to talk to him, he said, yeah, I guess you could put it in the paper. I just got a new TV show. It's going to be on ABC. Disney's picking it up, and it's called Home Improvement. And so I had the scoop on that. I interviewed Andrew Dice Clay for the cover of that when he was just starting. The night that after we broke the cover story with him, he was announced as headlining Madison Square Garden, so he jumped up to the next level.
Yeah.
And it's funny because when I initially interviewed Andrew Dice Clay, almost everything was like, yeah, okay, well, yeah, I guess so. And he was very guarded, and you know, and I asked about the gig, because I don't talk about, you know, characterizations or things like that. And a week after the interview came out, I got a phone call. They go, Andrew Silverstein's on the line for you. I was like, Andrew Silverstein? Okay. Right. So I picked the phone up, and it's him. And he's just like, John, I just wanted to say thanks, man. He goes, you know, I don't usually let my guard down on the characters that I do, and obviously this is a character, but you know, I didn't know what kind of a piece you were going to write, but you're a good guy. And thanks.
Oh, he read it?
Yeah, he actually read it.
He thanked you. Wow.
Yeah, and his PR company was like, hey, thanks, man. You know, everybody's out to get him right now. It's like,
you said that before. It's like there's so many people out there trying to rip you apart.
My attitude was always the same with every interview I ever went into in my life, and that is, hey, if I really didn't like somebody personally,
you wouldn't be into
I wouldn't talk to them. I just send somebody. If they really deserved press, I'd send somebody else to interview him and take myself out of the equation. So, but I never went in with an axe to grind with anybody or talked to somebody that, you know, I couldn't see that, hey, this is an act and there's a person behind the act that isn't the act.
Right.
So you got to be able to separate those things with all performers.
Yes, you do. And Joey Petroni's an act. I shouldn't tell you.
Got it.
The reason why I'm saying that is because, you know, like Saturday I'm going to be doing the chicken dance out in Riverhead.
Very cool. And it's a great town to do it in.
So this look doesn't go. But anyway, I want to thank you.
My pleasure, Jerry. Thank you for having me on.
I really appreciate it. And man, you got tons and tons and tons of stories. And I asked you what year you started coming here, just say like in the 80s. I always wanted to be a comedian. My uncle had Steve Martin's double live album with the rabbit ears.
Sure.
And I used to listen to that. I shouldn't have, Mike. It was cursing and all that kind of. But when nobody was home, I'd listen to Steve Martin. So I loved comedy. I grew up and I made everybody laugh as much as I could. And then I wanted to be a comedian so bad, and I couldn't come into Governors back then. I lived in Levittown. I'd ride my bike up here, believe it or not. I'd ride my bicycle around the parking lot. Isn't that crazy? I just wanted to be around comedy. I actually hung out in the parking lot of Governors when I was 15, 16, 17.
That's what people do, man. Yeah. They hang out where they're around the periphery of where a movie's being shot. They hang out at where they practice football, whatever it is that attracts you in life. You want to go meet the people that do what you respect and love.
Yeah, and I lived all the way down by MacArthur High School, so riding my bike up here, my mom would have killed me if she knew I was up here, you know, crossing Hempstead Turnpike and blah, blah, blah. And I also would go down to the Nassau Coliseum right up the road and hang outside the Nassau Coliseum during hockey games.
Me too.
And back then, you know, I don't know if you know, you might know, is that if you walked around the outside of the Coliseum, every now and then somebody come over and pop a door for you.
Yep.
And I'd get in.
You bet.
You know, but the one thing you had to worry about was your bike being there when you got out. But John, I really appreciate you being here.
Thank you so
I really
much for do. Having me.
You guys. Are Mr. Absolutely. Long Island, and you remind me of all my friends that I grew up with in the fields of music and stuff like that. You take it very serious, and it's an honor to have you on my show, really.
Thank you again.
All right. I thank you a lot.
Thank you, John.
Good times, bad times. Thank you for joining us, and we'll see you next time. Peace. Enjoy your summer.